we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see in his hands the mark of the nails, and put my finger into the mark of the nails, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. And 8 days after, his disciples were again with them, and Thomas with them. Jesus comes, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst of them. Peace be to you. Then he says to Thomas, bring your finger here and see my hands. And bring your hand and put it into my side. And be not unbelieving, but believing. Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. Jesus says to him, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed they who have not seen and have believed. Amen. Amen. Thus is the reading of the word of God. I want to talk about, from this subject, show your wounds. Show your wounds. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, let the words of my mouth and all the things, oh God, give me strength today to preach what you have called me to preach, to do what you called me to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I want to talk about show your wounds. Show your wounds. We all have scars from unsutured nicks of our childhood. Maybe it's from a bypass, a chest bypass surgery, or an empty ripple space from a mastectomy. Maybe it's scars from, you know, when you were a child. You know, and I was a young man in Texas. You know, we played outside with our bare feet. We ain't wear no shoes. We just like to go out in the backyard and in the pit back there and just run around. But it was always danger back there when you're out there with no shoes on. And of course, I remember one time that I stepped on a broken jaw and it cut my foot. And I still got that scar on my foot today. Sliced it till I could see the white. But you know what? I didn't go to the hospital. Mama just gave us some alcohol and some bandages. And that seemed, and gave me a kiss, and that seemed to make it better. Some scars are readily visible, and others are hidden and remain hidden from embarrassment. Yeah. And then there are the countless inner wounds, the griefs that never quite heal, wrongs that can never be righted, memories that cannot be erased, hurtful words or betrayals that seem to have a direct line to our tear ducts, or to the recurrent knot in our stomach. People say that sticks and stones will break your bones, but words will never hurt. They don't, maybe they haven't lived. Because we do know that words, in fact, have a lasting effect on us, more than sometimes our scars. I know sometimes I used to say this, I would rather for my mama to take a belt and whoop me than for her to sit there and scold me. Because the scolding continues to last with, you know, when your mama when your mama mad at you, and she started talking about, you know, it hangs on you tricky for a while. We are all scarred in one way or another. And you can't get through life without scars, inside or outside. The wounded Christ is the Lord and Savior of a wounded community. These scar tissues are all over the place. Even though we are in the church, sometimes we act like we are all floating above scars and wounds. It doesn't matter to us. But we're not fooling nobody. People can see our scars. They can see our wounds because we are a visible community. Nobody would want to be around a church where there's no hurting, where their people are not hurting or don't ever say they ever hurt. You know, you live life as if though nothing happened to you. But we are a wounded, broken, and forgiven people, singing and praising God in spite of our wounds, in spite of our scars. And that's why we're so glad to see Jesus with those gaping holes. So it's fascinating that when John tells the story of Jesus and his appearance to his disciples after the resurrection, he tells how Jesus shows them his scars. Not once, but twice. The risen Christ slips through the locked doors and appears before these frightened disciples. But they seem almost numb. So he shows them his wounded hands and his side. He makes a special point of it. Thomas was one of the disciples that wasn't there on the first appearance. He shows up a little late. And eventually the other disciples told him about Jesus. They say in John 20:25, they tell him about these scars that they see of Jesus. That's the proof that they have. And then look what Thomas says, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hands in his side, I'm not going to believe it. I'm not going to believe this is the Jesus that you saw. Because there's no way in the world that he can go through that and not have those wounds visible still. And a week later, the risen Christ surprises the disciples. This time, Thomas is there, and Jesus obliges his doubts. He says, come here, Thomas, put your finger here. And he holds out his hands. And there's no indication, the text doesn't tell us what Thomas did when he saw that, except that he was amazed. He was excited that this was Jesus. He falls to his knees. But I wonder, why does Jesus show the disciples his wounds? Prior to that, we wonder why he had wounds anyway. Wouldn't it make more sense to see a risen Lord to show himself in a resurrected body that's sleek and whole, no wounds, nothing, no problems, just a clean new Jesus. And if you remember, when he first came out and Mary saw him and Mary got ready to hug him, he said, hold it, don't touch me right now. Don't touch me right now. Maybe he was cleaned up. Maybe he had got all of the wounds and everything was cleaned up in him. I don't know. But when he met with the disciples, by the time he got to the disciples, his scars were still there. And what about our resurrection? When we rise on the last day, will we be raised with wrinkles, bald heads, gray hair? Well, I'm not quite sure, because the text says that we'll have a new body. So, you know, so the bad eyes that you might have, they'll clear up. I wish I had a prayer in church. All the stuff that you're missing, like teeth and all that kind of stuff, they'll show back up. I wish I had somebody with me today. When you pray with me this morning, you have a new situation. But the Bible indicates here that when Jesus came up, he still had his wounds. He still had his wounds. So I got to wondering why, and the Bible begins to help me understand why the wounds were still there. And the reality of the matter is, if you live in this life, if you live in the life of a Christian, you live in the life, you too are going to have some wounds. And I want you to know that your wounds are there for a reason. You just don't have wounds that are just wounds on their own. You, there's a reason for it. And I believe there are three reasons why Jesus showed his wounds, and there are three reasons why we should show our wounds. Amen?
Amen.
Turn to somebody and tell them to show your wounds. Tell your other neighbor. Say, neighbor, show your wounds. Yeah, I'm going to give them three reasons why you ought to show your wounds. First, I believe that Jesus showed his wounds as an insignia of his identity. He needed to identify himself. Look at John 20, the text says, when therefore it was evening on that day, which was the first day of the week, the doors being shut, through the fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst of them and says, peace be to you. And having said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Now listen, church. Jesus had to show his wounds because his disciples wanted to identify who he was. And listen to me. When you go through something, it can change you. But when you go through something with Jesus and God on your side, you don't look like what you've been through. I wish I had a prayer in church. So somebody may not identify you. Somebody may not know who you are because you sound different. You act different. You look different. You dress different. There's something different about you because you've been through something. So they may not know who you are. So you got to let them know that, yeah, I'm still the one. I'm still the one that went through. I am still the one. Sometimes you got to let people know. That's why you got to show your wounds, because you got to identify yourself. You may not look like what you've been through. You may look like a changed person. God has brought you through something. Have you ever been through something? Have you ever gone through something? I know my production guy. I know I got you some scriptures. I may not get to all of them, so just follow me. There you go, man. I'm not even preaching, but I got written down. Huh? I'm going somewhere else. I'm going somewhere else. But what I'm trying to get you to understand here is Jesus had to identify himself. He had to show his hands. He had to show his side, because they would not have known who he was. And then the second thing I want to help you with is this. Not only did he have to show him, but the wounds that you show also helps identify who you are. Listen to me. You may identify yourself to them, but your wounds also identify yourself to yourself. Watch this. Jesus tells us that he showed the disciples were, the text says, the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Verse 20. It is as though the wounds somehow opened them up to joy. No wounds, church. Guess what? No joy. No wounds, no joy. Why would the disciples be glad to see the wounds?
When Jesus showed them his wounds, it meant they could remember the pain that they all had experienced a few days earlier. The fear, the tears of remorse, the terrible hours watching him die. Their emptiness, their loneliness, their hopelessness. It was all there in those wounds. In his wounds, they were free to probe their own wounds. See, Peter said that when Jesus died, he was going back to fishing. The movement was over. I'm done. He ain't the one I thought he was, and I'm going back. Listen to me, church. When you are challenged with some faith, with some stuff that come into your life, your faith gets challenged. And you got to make a decision. Who are you? And whose are you? And where are you going to stand when trouble arrives? Where are you going to stand? Are you going to go back to your old ways? Or are you going to hold on to God's unchanging hand? You got to make a decision about who you are. And those wounds identify you about who you are and whose you are and where you're going to go with it. Because listen to me. When you are challenged, when your faith is challenged, there is something, it's like nothing you ever had before. I don't know about you. My faith has been challenged. But I got to make a decision whether I'm going to go do my thing or continue to hold on to where God wants me to be. Because see, I could always go back to do my thing. Because I'm comfortable with doing my thing. I know how to do my thing. You know, whatever my thing was, I know how to do it. Because I've been doing it for a while. I know how to do that. Yeah. But when you get challenged, when you come to the fork in the road, and you got to make a decision about whether you're going to stay on the straight and narrow or go to the wide where everybody is, you got to make a decision. You got to make a decision because those wounds are too hard, and the struggle with trying to hold on to God is a struggle we all do deal with. Some people think that it's easy to love somebody in the midst of hurt. I wish I had a praying church today. Yeah, it's hard to love somebody when you're hurting. It's hard to hold on to hope when you can't see no light. But you gotta trust in God. You gotta believe that God is able to take you through it. Crisis will come in your life. If you don't believe it, you better just hold on. But look what Jesus tells them. He says, I give you peace in the midst of your storm. And look here. You get three kinds of peace. You get the peace with God. You get the peace from God. And you get the peace of God. The peace with God is the work of Christ. That's what Jesus did on the cross when he died. So you get peace with God. In other words, you don't have no more fight with God. You and God are good because of what Jesus did. Jesus died on the cross and you accepted what he did. So you got peace with eternity. Oh yes, you got that kind of peace. You know where you're going when you leave this world. And that's some good news. Because all of us ought to know where we're going. Now you ain't got to worry about where other people are going. That ain't your business. See, our problem is we get so stuck on where other folk going. We want to judge other people. Look at other folk. But guess what? You got just as many issues and problems as they do. You can't look at nobody else. That's why we always get ourselves in trouble by condemning our young people. Young people make mistakes, but you made them 25 years ago. You made them 10 years ago. You made them the other day. But you want to blame them for their mistakes. But you get peace with God when you accept what Christ did. And then you get the peace from God. That peace emphasizes the source of all true peace. This peace comes from the peace, no matter what happens. It is from God, and nobody can take it away from you. It is knowing God's will be with you always until the end of the earth. It is a peace that comes from God. The peace you get from God, you can't get it from clubs. You can't get it from money. You can't get it from your history. You can't get it from nobody but Jesus Christ himself. Then you get the peace of God. It's the peace that's that inward peace that you get through prayer and supplication. When you commit yourself to the task of becoming a disciple, you develop an inward peace that makes you steady even when the storms of life begin to rage. When things begin to fall out of order, when things don't look right, you get a peace on the inside because you know that God says that all things are possible. And no matter what you do, God said, I'm going to fix it to make it work out in your favor. Are you with me today? Yes, sir. And then finally, because I'm almost done. Y'all been working with me today. So I'm almost done. Michael, are you with me today? I'm almost done, Doc, so get ready to hit me. So praise him is what I want, amen? I was going to do that at the beginning, but you can do it at the end. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Finally, I believe Jesus showed his wounds to propel us to purpose. Look at verse 20 and 21. Jesus says in verse 21, therefore, again to them, he says, peace to you. As the Father sent me forth, I also send you. And having said this, he breathed into them and says to them, receive the Holy Spirit. Yes. When Jesus appeared behind those locked doors to greet his fearful, wounded, ashamed disciples, he showed him his scars. It was like a kiss that confirmed their wounds. It was as if the Lord was saying, I know your wounds and I love you still. Isn't that marvelous? This isn't the last time in the Bible we see Jesus with his wounds. John sees it in his vision called Revelation. Look what the text says in Revelation 5:12. It says, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. I find it infinitely comforting that the wounded one is the object of heaven's praise. Look, church, when you get to heaven, the one we're going to be praising is the one who's been wounded. Yeah, 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 yeah. They're going to give him praise because he was wounded for us. In verse 22, the text says that Jesus said, I breathe on them, receive the Holy Spirit. The disciples received a new birth for the journey. The disciples who were once down and despondent, depressed and suppressed, were now resurrected. They had gone to the meeting with a tenant to talk and left with the power to preach. They were renewed in their convictions and their covenant. They were excited. They had new desires and new directions. They received the power to heal a sin-sick world, power to raise the dead, power to free people from oppression, power to free people from racism and sexism, power to heal the sick, power to have faith, power to change the world, power to love. They had new power. They had new purpose. Listen, when God comes into your life, he gives you a new purpose to prepare you to do what God called you to do. So the wounds are there to help you help somebody else. They're not there for you. They're there for you to help. Don't be ashamed to show your wounds. Your wounds are there for a purpose. Sometimes we think we go through stuff and it's embarrassing. It is. Because you think that you couldn't, you shouldn't have been the one to go through that. They shouldn't have done that to me. To me?
Yes.
Me?
Yes. Come on, Pastor. Yes.
Not me. And then what happens is the devil gets in.
Yeah.
He wants to use that. So he tells you to keep your mouth shut. Keep it to yourself.
Yes.
Don't tell nobody. But oh, when the Lord begins to work on you, you see somebody else hurting. You see somebody else going through. And every time they go through, the devil gets to work on and you. Nobody else has gone through what you've been through. The devil is a lie. There is nothing under the sun that man has not gone through. Nothing that you've gone through that somebody else haven't gone through. You got breast cancer? There's somebody else who got breast cancer. Who the Lord brought through. That can help you get through it. You got a failing marriage? The Lord got somebody else who's had a failing marriage. That can help you get through it. You've been broke? Don't know where you're going to get your next meal from? God got somebody else who's been broke. That can bring them through. You ain't the only one. That's what happened to Elijah. Got under a juniper tree. Said, Lord, all these people done forsake you except me. I'm the only one. I'm your only prophet. God said, shut your mouth up, boy. You ain't the only one that's standing up for me. I got thousands who are standing up for me. Get up. Do what the Lord told you to do. And what I'm trying to tell you, church, that when the Holy Spirit comes in, it blows out fear. It blows in faith. It blew out doubt. It blew in hope. It blew out hate. It blew in love. It blew out envy. It blew in unity. It blew out frustration. It blew in commitment. It blew out fighting. It blew in cooperation. When the Holy Spirit comes in, it gives you a new purpose to do what God told you to do. Give him praise. He's worthy to be praised. God got something for you in your hurt, in your wounds, in your sorrows. God still want to use you. Give him praise. He's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be praised. Worthy to be praised. Oh Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord, for the wounds. Now, Lord, help us to be bold enough to show our wounds. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church, will you stand with me? There might be somebody here in the house today who's heard the word of God. If you're here, we invite you to come. Let me also do this, because we are on the live stream. So there may be somebody here today that's listening to me on the television right now, on the stream. And maybe you haven't accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you would do right now, if you would bow your head with me right now, let me pray a prayer with you. Heavenly Father, I accept you as my Lord and Savior. Forgive me of my sins and accept me as your son and your daughter. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, you have been saved. So we invite you to come right now for those who are in the house. If you're here and you haven't needed a church home, we invite you to come. Those who need prayer, we invite you to come stand around the altar. You're worthy, Lord. You're worthy to be praised. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you.
Again, the church responds. Amen. Go in peace.